French mathematician and philosopher, Blaise Pascal, earned his reputation as a precocious and brilliant scientist. He designed an early calculating machine and worked on the theory of probability. But he also famously said,
"The heart has its reasons, of which reason knows nothing. We know the truth, not only through our reason, but also through our heart."
Pascal was not opposed to reason, but he believed that what we can articulate and prove is only a part of what we know. The reasons we give for our attitudes and our behaviour may only be the tip of the iceberg of the reasons our hearts know but cannot speak. I've always been fascinated by the relationship between learning and language, between what the heart knows and what we can articulate. So it's ironic that I'm about to explore it mostly by using words. Sigmund Freud describes a game that he watched a small boy playing. The boy was about 18 months old and could talk only a little, but he designed for himself an elaborate and satisfying game, which brought him endless pleasure.
The child had a wooden reel with a piece of string tied around it. It never occurred to him to pull it along the floor behind him, for instance, and play at its being a carriage. What he did was to hold the reel by the string and very skillfully throw it over the edge of his curtained cot so that it disappeared into it, at the same time uttering his expressive ooh, ooh, ooh. He then pulled the reel out of the cot again by the string and hailed its reappearance with a joyful da, meaning there. And this then was the complete game, disappearance and return. As a rule, one only witnessed its first act, which was repeated untiringly as a game in itself, though there is no doubt that the greater pleasure was attached to the second act. The interpretation of the game then became obvious. It was related to the child's great cultural achievement, the instinctual renunciation. That is, the renunciation of instinctual satisfaction, which he had made in allowing his mother to go away without protesting. He compensated himself for this, as it were, by himself staging the disappearance and return of the objects within his reach. Her departure had to be enacted as a necessary preliminary to her joyful return, and that it was in the latter that lay the true purpose of the game.
Of course, Sigmund Freud is wrapping words and reason around the child's game, despite the fact that the child cannot confirm or deny the explanation Freud gives. The game he's playing is powerful magic for controlling the world, but it doesn't need words to work.
Good evening, Rowan. It's the 20th of November 2016, and it's about 8 o'clock. And obviously, this is my usual Sunday evening video to reassure you I haven't been seducing any priests over the weekend, because obviously I know how much that infuriates you, so I'm determined to proceed on that path. But as soon as you're in prison and it doesn't matter anymore, I'm going to be in the arms of my beloved, because he's so wonderful and we're made for each other and we're saving ourselves until the moment when we can be together in each other's arms, all loved up forever. So anyway, I thought we could have a chat this evening about an article that you wrote in the New Statesman, which was published in the print edition on the 17th of November 2016, but has only been made available online today, the 20th of November. So you should be seeing the title of this piece, shall we say, at the moment. Mass democracy has failed. It's time to seek a humane alternative. Well, I like the word of the use, humane, here. Humane, when you talk about treating things humanely, you tend to be talking about animals. You generally don't talk about treating people in a humane way because it's kind of assumed that you will treat them in a humane way because they are in fact human. So humane tends to be used in relation to animals, really, that you're treating animals humanely. And maybe if you're treating human beings in a bad way, you might say that's inhumane, but you don't tend to talk about treating human beings humanely. It tends to be reserved for animals, this this word, humane. So that's already very interesting. Now, unfortunately, there's so much lunacy in this article, which is actually a very short article, that I'm only going to cover one statement this evening. And you've already seen a couple of clips that relate to this. So I'm going to come on to talking about this statement you've made just now, and you should be seeing it on the video in a minute. So here's the statement from this article that I was talking about. The problem is deeper. Trump's campaign succeeded in spite of the cast iron demonstrations of his total indifference to truth, not to mention decency. So this is quite a staggering statement from you. I mean, first of all, even if it were true that there was cast iron demonstrations of Donald Trump's total indifference to truth, which I don't think there is, actually. I haven't heard anything like that. But I think you've got a total indifference to truth. You live in a fantasy world and you can't tell the difference between fantasy and reality, as I've talked about before. So even if it were true, I do find it absolutely staggering that you could make this statement about anybody. It's just astonishing. And the further demonstration of the fact that you invariably accuse other people of things of which you yourself are guilty. So you then say, not to mention decency. Well, let's talk about decency, because if somebody is a decent person, there's two connotations to this. This is the first one. If someone's a decent person, it means they're a relatively moral person. They treat people appropriately. They tend to tell the truth. They don't lie and steal. They tend to be kind. They try to do the right thing. They live a decent life. They're not involved in any shady activities. So that's one definition of decency, or one connotation of decency, should I say. Now, the other connotation of decency is a sexual connotation, isn't it? So you might be referring to the conversation that was recorded of Donald Trump talking with another man when he thought he was talking in private and making some quite lewd remarks about a female TV presenter. She didn't hear any of this, and this took place about 15 years ago or something, and he thought he was talking in private, and it seemed to me like it was meant to be light-hearted and a joke. So let's contrast that with you, because this word decency has this sexual connotation, like if you're decent, one meaning of that is that you're clothed appropriately enough to be seen in public. So that's one meaning of decent in this sense. And indecent behaviour is behaving in a sexual way in public, where you should only behave in that way in private, really. So that would be being indecent. For example, by masturbating in front of somebody like David Peake did in front of me. So he did it with his hands in his pockets, so I didn't actually see his genitals, but it was still an indecent act, so that was indecency. So your perverted astrophysical clergy friend behaved indecently. And then, of course, Michael Cross indecently assaulted me. This used to be a term in English law, indecent assault, but they've changed it to sexual assault now. But he did rub his hands up and down, well, one of his hands. his left hand, in fact, up and down on my right breast. So that was indecent. So these people that you were controlling behaved indecently towards me. And also, you're indecent, aren't you, by your frequent references and allusions to sex in contexts where it's not appropriate, really. And it's quite unusual for somebody to be making public speeches and statements, like, for example, to a group of sixth formers, where you're making references and allusions to sex. And you do that very frequently for anybody, I mean, not just the Archbishop of Canterbury. I mean, it's not like you're a stand-up comedian or anything who's making people laugh by making these references. So it's not really appropriate. So you're not really decent in that sense either, are you? And then, of course, there's also the fact that you tried to get your leg over when I came to see you to talk about being a deacon in the church in Wales. And that was in July 1994. And then, of course, your wife was indecent as well, really, wasn't she? Talking about semen in that lecture where she was supposed to be talking about women priests. And talking about semen and then leaning towards me and smiling and saying, "So now you know all about women priests." So that was quite indecent, really, wasn't it? And so I also think that you're talking about decency because I've talked about your romantic habits, shall we say, and the fact that you dumped your fiancé at a very late stage in your engagement in order to get involved with Jane, your wife, your current wife. And I'm sure the reason for that wasn't because her father was a bishop and you thought it would help your career. So I think, because there's a clip about this later on, but you've got this kind of Madonna and whore complex, haven't you? And so the females in your life, like your wife and your daughter, they're special people because they're associated with you. And I'm a whore. You've decided that in your deluded and perverted sexual fantasies, because I make you feel threatened. You have to denigrate me in any way that you can. Now, you could have gone round the world saying that I was a thief or a compulsive liar or something like that if you wanted to slander me, couldn't you? But because you've got this obsession with sex, which I've shown many examples of that, then your fantasies about me were sexual fantasies, weren't they? And I'm showing a couple of clips actually from the talks that you gave about your. About the Desert Fathers in August 2015, which was about a month after I'd been kicked out of my house, and you were convinced I was going to capitulate at that. But in fact, I didn't, so you went kind of berserk. And I've mentioned this before, which I'm going to refer to because it's in one of these clips where you talk about. An old man. Basically, you shouldn't roam around from one church to another, is what you're saying. You've said over and over again about people not being allowed to leave and you have to stay in the ecclesial community where God has put you, meaning I had to stay in the Church of England because God said so. And obviously, you're God, so if you say so, then it must be true. And you've redefined heresy to mean that no one's allowed to leave the Church of England. Otherwise, they're a heretic, even to join another denomination of Christians, I mean. So you were talking about this in the talks that you gave, which are in several videos about the Desert Fathers. I've commented on all of them before, but I just want to mention it again because of your reference to decency and the fact that you're having sexual fantasies about me. And you talk about some people not roaming around from one old man to the other, the old man who's taking care of you. And I've said before that old man is a euphemism for the penis, and taking care of a woman is a euphemism for having sex with her. So this is what I think the connotation was in this lecture, and also in the context where you're talking about being present in the body and being saved in the body, and the sun moving inside us and that kind of thing. So I think this is what you're referring to in these lectures, and I'm showing those clips. But I just want to come on to your wife once again, and in fact her behaviour was very indecent, and she's colluding with you in your psychopathic endeavours, shall we say. All psychopaths have enablers, as I've said before. And I just want to mention Sigmund Freud again, because I mentioned before that Sigmund Freud's grandson actually knocked up one of your wife's sisters. So they're big fans of Sigmund Freud in her family. I'm not actually a big fan of Sigmund Freud. I think a lot of what he said was total crap. And I think that he was a psychopath, actually. He was a Jewish supremacist, a secular Jew, but a Jewish supremacist. And if you read about the way that he interacted with his patients, who were very often young women, it's not very pleasant at all. And he was encouraging other people, other therapists, to be screwing their patients and breaking all these boundaries and stuff. So he wasn't really a very nice man at all, and he was quite obsessed with sex, and he was a philanderer as well. So Freud's insights, shall we say, into people's sexual attitudes and behaviour, I haven't really got a great deal of confidence in these things. But anyway, so in the clip I played earlier on, your wife is talking about Freud and trying to imply in this Schrödinger's communication that's both happening and not happening at the same time, that I've got some kind of Freudian Oedipal complex or something, and this is why I'm reading all this stuff into what you're saying. It's not really there, even though it's really there when she's communicating, although of course it's not really there at the same time. But the point is, you see, I'd be a bit careful invoking Sigmund Freud if I were your wife, because let's look at her for a start. Well, her father was a clergyman who abandoned her at the age of 5 by sending her off to a boarding school, and she's still very traumatised by that, as I demonstrated in the video that I made about that, where I showed a clip of her talking about that and how traumatised she still was by it, and she still felt weepy talking about it, even all these years later. So her father was a clergyman, and he abandoned her at the age of 5, and then she married a clergyman. Well, let's look at me by contrast, because, well, my father was with me all the time that I was growing up. And when I started school when I was 4, my father did shift work, so he was often working weekends. He was a painter and decorator, and he worked for the Central Electricity Generating Board, and he did shift work, so he was often working weekends. Well, when I started school, he changed his shifts and took a cut in pay, so that he could see me at the weekends and take me out to nice places like the park to feed the ducks and things like that at the weekend. So he took a cut in pay to be with me because he knew he wouldn't see very much of me once I started school, because I'd be going to bed not long after he came home from work. So he changed his shifts and took a cut in pay so he could continue to see a lot of me and still take me out to nice places, which he wouldn't have been able to do so much if he'd continued doing shift work. And then when I got older and I wasn't going to bed so early, then he changed his shifts back again, so he was working weekends and earning more money. So that's what my father did for me, and he was with me all the time until I left home. And I still had a relationship with him as well until he died in 1998. And by contrast, your wife's father abandoned her, and he was a clergyman, and then she married a clergyman. Now, I didn't marry anybody, but I did have two long-term boyfriends in my late teens and in my 20s. And both of them had been to university, and one was an engineer and the other was a computer systems designer. Oh, and my father also left school at the age of 12 as well, because that's when gypsy children are taken out of school often. Certainly they were in the past, because 12 is the age when a Romani child becomes an adult. So that's the contrast between me and your wife there in terms of choosing romantic partners. So I'd be a bit careful invoking Sigmund Freud if I were her, because I don't think people in glass houses should throw stones, Janie. So you're talking about decency here when both you and your wife are completely screwed up on sexual matters, and you've got all this unresolved Oedipal stuff, if it even exists at all. I just think you're both trying to recreate the circumstances of your childhood and trying to make a better outcome from it, rather than looking at all the pain and suffering that you experienced then. I mean, particularly you, because you were ill and then disabled and sick quite a lot and off school, which wasn't anybody's fault, but your mother was a nightmare and didn't relate to you in an appropriate way. She made her strongest relationship with you because your father was very remote in the family, as I've said before. And it wasn't that he was unsocial either, because he was actually a Freemason. So he was socialising with the Freemasons. He just couldn't be bothered with you and your mother. So he was useless and a waste of space as far as being a parent was concerned. And then your mother was this really obnoxious old bitch. You were from a Welsh-speaking family. She wouldn't allow you to speak Welsh. She wouldn't let people speak Welsh in front of you. So you never learnt Welsh, which was the main language of your family, even though you were living in English-speaking areas, really, from the age of four. And this is why I think you've got this obsession with speaking all these languages, or pretending you speak a lot of languages that you don't actually speak, because your mother prevented you from learning Welsh. So that excluded you even further. And then, when you were consecrated Bishop of Monmouth, in 1992, she was complaining to someone at the ceremony that you could have got a decent job, like being a bank manager or something like this. So she had this really obnoxious attitude, a very controlling person. And also, one of her relatives wouldn't even come in the house when you were a child because your behaviour was so obnoxious. So she didn't discipline you properly. And she wouldn't allow you to interact with other people in a natural way. And then she had this kind of unnatural relationship with you, which should have been reserved for a husband. And maybe it would have been if he hadn't been useless. So you had this completely dysfunctional family. You completely screwed up, both of you. And you particularly are obsessed with sex. And you've got this idea of, you've got this kind of Madonna whore thing going on in your head, which there's a clip about that a bit later on, which I'm going to explain in a minute. So the women who are associated with you and who give you what you want, they're kind of the Madonna figures in your life. And people like me who make you feel threatened, make you feel inadequate and inferior, because I'm vastly more competent than you, and I haven't got the patience for creeps like you, basically, and for bullshit merchants. I can't tolerate bullshit, it does my head in. So I haven't got the time for you. I wouldn't have sex with you. You can't stand this narcissistic injury. So you've got all these sexual fantasies about me because you were never able to dominate me and possess me sexually, which wasn't even about attraction. You just wanted the trophy, really. You wanted to feel that you'd got me, you were in control of me, and that you could have whoever you wanted. And so this is why you tried to get your leg over, really. It wasn't even really about attraction, I don't think, even though I was a young woman at the time and you were much older. You were in your 40s and I was 25. So you've got all this disturbed sexual stuff going on in your head. And because you're so narcissistic, you can't handle the fact that I refused your sex. So the only explanation you'll tolerate for that is that I'm a lesbian. And also, while you're imagining that I'm a lesbian, this enables you to believe that I kind of belong to you in a way, that I'm not being possessed in any way at all by any other man, because you'd find that very threatening. So you think you can possess me because you're imagining that I'm a lesbian. You've decided that I am, in fact, haven't you? Because you're God and you create people and decide their characters and you decide how they're going to behave and who they're allowed to be involved with and what the outcome of the situation's going to be. So you've decided that I'm a lesbian and this is what you're fantasizing about. And also, if I ever show any romantic interest in another man, there has to be an ulterior motive for it, you see. It couldn't just be that I find the man attractive for whatever reason, because you can't handle the fact that I didn't find you attractive, that I rejected you, I didn't want you, and you're so affronted by that, that you have to invent these stories that if I show any romantic interest in another man, there's some ulterior motive to that. Either I want his money, or I want his status, or I want him to do something for me, and this would be the reason why I would be showing a romantic interest in him. Because you can't handle the fact that I might just find him attractive and I don't find you attractive. Like, for example, I find my beloved phenomenally attractive and gorgeous and perfect. And we're made for each other, and I just can't wait to be in his arms. So that I think is the dynamic that's going on with you. And then you went around the world, as I've mentioned very, very many times before, spreading all these lies about me. So here you are saying that Donald Trump is indifferent to the truth. When you went around telling all these lies about me that you knew were lies, and you also knew that you'd tried to have sex with me and I refused you, you knew that, and yet you were going around telling people that I was a delinquent sex maniac, a fantasist, a repressed lesbian, and a prostitute. And particularly, you knew that I wasn't a prostitute, as I've said, because you knew where I was actually working and you were interfering in my secular employment as well. So this is all your indecency. So you're accusing Donald Trump of not having decency, whereas in fact you are a phenomenally indecent person in every meaning of the word. Like you don't exhibit any moral behaviour or tell the truth or anything like that. That's one meaning of decency. And then with its sexual connotation, you're indecent as well. So I've put some clips together about these talks, from these talks that you gave about the Desert Fathers. And then I've also put on a clip of an interview with a female porn star where she's talking about the kind of men who are interested in watching lesbian porn and the way that they behave towards the female porn stars who are acting in these lesbian sex scenes, I suppose. So she says it's quite self-explanatory, actually, but she's talking about, I suppose, the kind of attachment that some men who watch lesbian porn get to these porn stars. They think they've got some kind of relationship from them. She doesn't say this explicitly, but she seems to be implying from what she says that these men are fantasizing about these female porn stars in these lesbian sex scenes. And then if they imagine that they've got some kind of relationship with the woman, because they don't see her with any other men. And then, if they later see her in another porn film with a male, then they go, berserk about this, they can't handle it and start writing hate mail to the female porn star. And the reason I'm showing this clip is because I think this is the kind of fantasy that you've got about me being a lesbian. Because if I was a lesbian, then maybe I'm not belonging to you in a kind of concrete sense, but you have got a fantasy relationship with me, because you talk about being reconciled and being reunited, when, as I've said also many times before, if you're going to be reunited with somebody, you need to really be united with them in the first place, and then have that relationship broken, and then you're reunited. But I can't be reunited with you, because we were never united in the first place. You were never anything to me. It's all in your head. You've got this fantasy relationship with me, and you're trying to force me to make it an actual relationship by all this evil behaviour, as I've also demonstrated in many videos before. So this clip from this porn star, Mercedes is her first name, Mercedes Carrera, this is the name of the female porn star who's talking about this theme, and it's a clip from a much longer interview where she's talking about porn generally and her own experience of being a porn actress. So this is the dynamic that I think is going on with you and you having fantasies about me being a lesbian, because then you can imagine that I somehow still belong to you and that I'm unsullied by being attracted to other men, when obviously I wasn't attracted to you, I refused you, so there must be something wrong with me. And it just can't be that I think you're a creep. I wouldn't have been interested in you anyway, even if you hadn't already been married to someone else, because I think you're a creep. You're an exceptionally weak man. You're dishonest. You never tell the truth. And I just couldn't be doing with all this arty-farty bullshit either. I just don't find those kind of things attractive in anybody. People who talk shit all the time, I haven't got the patience for at all. And also people who try to manipulate me and try to force me to do things I don't want to do. And people who treat me in a bad way, in a disrespectful way, I haven't got any patience for that kind of thing. So you'd get short shrift from me anyway, even if you hadn't been married to someone else, and even if I had been looking for a partner at the time, I still wouldn't have been interested in you, because you're just a creep and you're pathetic. I just haven't got the patience. I've got no interest in mummies, boys whatsoever, and I never would have. So anyway, so I've been talking for quite a long time by now on this simple one statement that you made in this article, which is from start to finish jam-packed with lunacy. So I'll probably make some other videos about it as well this week, probably. But I'll leave it there for now. But I am still saving myself to be with my beloved and to get my hands on those magnificent feet. I've been flexing my fingertips at the very thought of it. I really am the best, you know, at foot massages. I think the secret's in a really firm grip. Anyway, I shall leave it there, but I will be turning up to arrest you for terrorism, so you've got that to look forward to. So don't forget to be alert. Hasta la próxima.
Life, death, and neighbours. I want to express the warmest of thanks to the World Community for Christian Meditation for their invitation to be here, because an invitation to address a group like this is always an open door into discovery for oneself. Many years I've lived as an ascetic, and everybody praises me, but though I'm an old man, I still have a lot of trouble with sexual fantasy.
What I'm probing for, I think,
is a willingness to stop and look at how we're feeling. There's a big difference between lashing out and saying, ah, I'm angry. And that's a very small thing, but it's the beginning of understanding that my immediate upsurge of feeling is not, as I said, the be-all and end-all. I'm angry. I'm impatient. I'm lustful. I'm greedy. Okay, stop and look. As it were, put it on the table in front of you and say, yeah, that's how I'm feeling. That's what we have language for. It's to put things where we can see them. And where others can as well. Because staying, Amma Syncletica said, if you find yourself in a monastery, do not go to another place, for that will harm you a great deal. Just as the bird who abandons the eggs she was sitting on prevents them from hatching, so the monk or the nun grows cold and their faith dies when they go from one place to another. Our friend Moses the Black again. A brother came to Scetus to visit Abba Moses and asked him for a word. The old man said to him, go, sit in your cell, and your cell will teach you everything. Sit in your cell, and your cell will teach you everything. One of the things that the Desert Fathers most frequently return to is the problem of the rootless ascetic, the person who is always looking for the best place to be. This isn't quite good enough. I could be really holy if I was somewhere else. The old man who is looking after me here in the desert is not quite as spiritual and inspiring as some old men. I'm not quite sure who they are, but I'm sure I could find them if I left and looked. That's the problem as it presents itself in general terms of stability, but it's analyzed with even more wit and perception by the great Evagrius at the end of the 4th century. When he provides the first sustained discussion in Christian literature of the problem of what's sometimes called acadia or axidy, the sort of listlessness, depression, restlessness that comes out of boredom. The fleeing that we were thinking about yesterday, running away is not running from the real world, but running into it, running into reality from the various kinds of managed and manipulated unreality which we habitually live in the midst of. Hence, everything comes finally to staying, pledging the body. Only in the body is the soul saved. It can sound, can't it, as if going to the desert in this tradition is going into a kind of nowhere. Going into the desert is not going to be nowhere. It's going to discover a very particular kind of somewhere. To be yourself, your body, with these people in this place. With the sand and the rock and the extraordinarily annoying monk in the next hut. And the intense boredom of basket making. Anchor yourself. You just have to be there to make this your place. Only in the body, through the body, is the soul saved. Only as myself, my body, pledged in this place, am I healed. And being my body, pledged in this place, is being with, pledged to, the others God has given me here. A here that may be a monastic community, a here that may be a family, a here that may be a church, full of people with whom I'm in all sorts of deep disagreement. Because it's not only in the monastic life that we think I could be so holy if only I was somewhere else. We all of us have somewhere in our minds that wonderful dream of the real church that we ought to be able to occupy. The real church that's full of people like me. And the church that God gives me is, of course, dramatically different from that. And the pledging of my body to the actual ecclesial community that's there, with all its faults and its horrors and its nuisances, its frustrations, and sometimes its outrages. That also is part of what God asks of us, because only in the togetherness does healing happen.
God has spoken to us in particulars. God has anchored the divine life in a body. A body that literally lived and died on this earth. A body that rose from the grave, and a body that now exists in the concrete reality of embodied Christian people by the gift of the Holy Spirit. If that's the case, then our healing is bound to be connected with the where and the who and the when. That's where we are meant to be. That's where meaning and glory descend. That's the cell. And as we turn repeatedly to God in the silence of contemplation, in the ordinariness of daily duty, just once in a while, perhaps, we catch a glimpse round the corner of our vision of the fire that actually surrounds us, in which the Son of God moves with us in the body and through time. A desert filled with flame.
All right. Hey, everybody. It's Gad Saad for The Saad Truth. I'm here with the adult film star Mercedes Carrera. Very excited to have her on the show. We'll be talking about the science of porn. We'll be talking about her own experiences in the porn industry. Maybe we'll bring in some consumer behavior angles to the discussion. So I'm very much looking forward to it. Thank you so much for doing this, Mercedes.
Thank you so much for having me, Gad. I'm so excited to talk with you. I've been so excited this week. The other part, the other side, and I do a lot of lesbian pornography.
Right.
Like, and a lot of that is either older, younger, initiating a younger woman into lesbianism. But the biggest market, the watching market on that, tends to be men. And again, usually the men who are watching that, it's triggering their Oedipal complex, but they don't want to watch any men in it. They want to watch two women.
Right.
But there's a lot of mommy talk. There's a lot of that kind of thing. And there are the men who tend to want to watch lesbian pornography are men who are not inherently sexually competitive. So they like the idea of they're interested in seeing. And this is interesting. A lot of the female performers, there's a pathway that a lot of them take. They start doing solos, and then they usually start stripping, and then they do solos, then they do girl only, then they transition to boy girl, and then from there, you know, the list grows.
Right.
But what's fascinating is the girls who go in and do girl only. And I'm very solidly bisexual. Like on the Kinsey scale, I'm like right there in the middle.
And you mean in your performance career or in your personal life as well?
Personally. And then so my performance life actually it's funny how performance ends up mirroring exactly, because usually I draw boundaries around my performance that I'm comfortable with.
Right.
So it's not a shock. And also the things I like doing, I get booked for. So it's also not a shock that I do them. But a lot of the women who do girl only with a plan to transition to doing boy girl, a lot of the male fans are just devastated when they see this woman. A lot of them have that kind of Madonna whore complex going on.
Right.
And the men who have that active in their psyches tend to love the girl because the girls are unsullied.
Right.
But it's kind of the virgin archetype,
right.
And then when they see them finally perform with a penis, they go, no, I can't see it. I don't want to watch it.
Right.
And they'll get angry letters from fans. I knew you weren't really a lesbian. I just knew it, you know.
Wow.
So, yeah. Bong, bong, hey, pour me a beer. No pretty drinks, I'ma get it.
why Catholics have the best sex.